Hello everybody and happy Halloween. Welcome back to my channel. Welcome back to Halloween. We've been having a great season so far and there's more to come. Like I said in the last video, if I don't get all the Halloween videos out in October, it's just gonna go into November, and that's fine because sometimes life, that's how it be. And we're gonna keep going and we're gonna keep moving and get all the Halloween content out to you that your hearts desire. Also, stay tuned to the end of the video. A lot of people have been asking in the comments what eyeshadow I've been wearing and what lip colors I've been wearing this past month while I've been recording. And since mostly it's only been one palette, I'm gonna let you guys know what that is at the end so you can check it out if you want. Today, we're talking about a case that is super creepy, guys. Super creepy, perfect for Halloween. And it's one of those cases that even I, at the end of my research, was like, I'm dying to know who this was. What happened? I want this to be solved. I'm so interested. So I'm really excited to get your guys' viewpoints and get your opinions on what could be going on in this case, because I always feel like you guys enlighten me a lot and you make me think about things and consider angles that I hadn't before. So bear with me today. I've been up since 5. I already recorded my fall favorites video this morning and then I had a morning meeting at Starbucks. So I've had a lot of coffee. So if I'm a little high energy here, that's why. Let's get started on the video. Today we're talking about the Watcher House. And guys, if you've never heard about this case before, or you've never heard about it in depth, you're in for a wild ride. A wild ride. So this story centers around the Broaddus family, Derek and Maria and their children, and the experience that they had when they bought their dream house, essentially. And it wasn't a good experience. In June of 2014, Derek and Maria Broaddus became the happy owners of 657 Boulevard, a 3,900 square foot home in the New Jersey suburb of Westfield. This home would be the realization of a dream for both the married couple and their three young children. Maria had grown up in Westfield, in a house just a few blocks away, and Derek, originally from a working-class family in Maine, worked hard and hustled in his career to eventually become the senior vice president of a Manhattan insurance firm. This house is beautiful, inside and out, built in 1905, colonial style, with those gorgeous high ceilings perfect for an enormous Christmas tree, big windows with lots of natural light, hardwood floors, crown molding, a beautiful kitchen. It's the perfect home, all the style of early 1900s colonial period, which typically mirrored English manor homes with grand entrance halls, polished wood floors, muted color palettes, mixed with the best modern amenities like stainless steel, granite, and walk-in closets. Seriously, guys, if I could create my dream home, it would look like this. They have a fireplace in the dining room. It's so fancy, I can't even imagine just sitting down, eating like dinner at your huge dining room table while the fire is blazing right next to you. It's perfect. It's a gorgeous house. So naturally, the Broadduses were pumped. They were excited. Like I said, Derek worked really hard to give his children a life that he didn't necessarily have. Westfield had great schools, and it was close enough to New York City for Derek to commute to work every day, but he was still able to give his family that suburban life with the big yard so they could have a dog and run around and get fresh air. Westfield is that kind of neighborhood where the neighbors get together and they play games of euchre. I mean, this place has block parties. If you go on Westfield, New Jersey's like web page or their website, it talks about the town and the neighborhood's long tradition of block parties. It's probably the only thing that I don't like about that house because I don't go out of my way to socialize with the neighbors, but Derek and Maria would soon find that their neighbors weren't everything they appeared to be. The kids were excited about the house. They were already picking out which of the four bedrooms would be theirs. They were already picking out which of the fireplaces Santa Claus would come down on Christmas Eve. Derek went to the house on June 5th, 3 days after they closed. He needed to touch up some paint, and he also wanted to kind of get a rough idea of what changes they wanted to make to the interior. They were bringing workmen in to do renovations before the family moved in. Almost as if it was a habit, he walked to the mailbox, and obviously they hadn't really moved in yet, so there wasn't much mail in there, but there was a letter. It was a white envelope, almost the size of like a greeting card envelope. There was no return address on it, only the words, "To the new owners," written in big, thick, black letters. Inside, there was a typed letter, which said the following. "Dearest new neighbor at 657 Boulevard, allow me to welcome you to the neighborhood. How did you end up here? Did 657 Boulevard call to you with its force within? 657 Boulevard has been the subject of my family for decades now, and as it approaches its 110th birthday, I have been put in charge of watching and waiting for its second coming. My grandfather watched the house in the 1920s. My father watched it in the 1960s. It is now my time. Do you know the history of the house? Do you know what lies within the walls of 657 Boulevard? Why are you here? I will find out." The letter went on to chastise Derek for having contractors there to do renovations, saying, "I see that you have already flooded 657 Boulevard with contractors so that you can destroy the house as it was supposed to be. Tisk tisk, bad move. You don't want to make 657 Boulevard unhappy." And then, as if this wasn't creepy enough, the letter goes on to talk about and refer to Derek and Maria's three young children. "You have children. I have seen them. So far, I think there are three that I have counted. More on the way? Do you need to fill the house with the young blood I requested? Better for me. Was your old house too small for your growing family, or was it greed to bring me your children? Once I know their names, I will call to them and draw them to me. Who am I? There are hundreds and hundreds of cars that drive past 657 Boulevard each day. Maybe I am in one. Look out any of the many windows in 657 Boulevard at all the people who stroll by each day. Maybe I am one. Welcome, my friends. Welcome. Let the fun begin. Signed, The Watcher." I mean, at this point, I'm out, right? The letter's talking about young blood, talking about calling my children to them. I'm out. But this was at 10 p.m. You know, it's pretty late at night. Derek's standing outside reading this letter in full view of whoever is watching. And he's rightfully terrified. So he runs inside the house, he turns off the lights, and he calls the police. When the officers arrive, Derek shows them the letter, but obviously the police can't make heads or tails of it either. He asks Derek if they have enemies or if there was somebody who didn't want them to move into the house. But Derek can't think of anyone. Derek left 657 Boulevard and he went home to the previous home that the family was occupying before they bought this new house. He and his wife talk about this letter and they decide that they need to contact John and Andrea Woods, the couple that they purchased the home from. The Woods were in their 60s at this point. They had two sons, but their sons were grown and had already moved out, so they were looking to downsize. 657 Boulevard was too much house for them, so they were selling it and they were moving to East Falmouth, Massachusetts. However, this letter had mentioned the Woods by name, saying that he'd asked them to send fresh blood his way and that they'd listened. The Broaddus's emailed the Woods asking them if they knew anything about this letter or if they had received any letters similar to this while they'd lived at the house. And they wanted to know why this watcher person was alleging that he had colluded with the Woods in order to bring Derek, Maria, and their children to 657 Boulevard. Andrea Woods wrote back the next morning and she said she had no idea who this watcher person was or why he had mentioned herself and her husband, but come to think of it, she too had received a letter. It had been back in May, a few days before they moved out. The letter had made mention of this person, this watcher, and his family watching the house for years, but the Woods claimed that they'd never received any letters like this in the 23 years they'd occupied the home, so they had written it off as a prank or a hoax. Not thinking anything of it, dismissing it, they tossed the letter out. Both Maria Broaddus and Andrea Woods went to the police station that day to see if they could get to the bottom of who was sending these letters. The detective they spoke to said there would be an investigation, but that Maria should not mention the letters to anyone, especially their new neighbors who could potentially be suspects at this point. Over the next few weeks, Derek and Maria avoided being in the house as much as they possibly could. No letters arrived at the house, but one morning, a contractor who showed up to do some work on the house found that a sign he'd hammered into the lawn the night before had been pulled up and thrown into the yard. The Broadduses regarded everybody with suspicious eyes, and they saw the watcher everywhere they looked. Derek had given another couple from the neighborhood a tour of the house. They'd been interested in seeing what kind of renovations that the Broaddus's were doing inside. And the woman in the couple remarked, "It'll be nice to have some young blood in the neighborhood," causing Derek to stare at her completely shocked and open-mouthed, since that was the exact verbiage that the watcher had used in his letter. But the letters were not done coming. 2 weeks after getting the first one, Maria checked the mail and found another crisp white envelope waiting for them. The letter was addressed directly to the Broaddus's, even though they'd spelled their surname incorrectly. It said, "Welcome to your new home at 657 Boulevard. The workers have been busy, and I have been watching you unload cartfuls of your personal belongings. The dumpster's a nice touch. Have they found what is in the walls yet? In time, they will." More terrifying yet, the writer of the letter called each of the Broaddus's children by name, listing them in order of their birth. The letter said, "I am pleased to know your names now and the names of the young blood you have brought to me. You certainly say their names often." With horror, Maria realized that the times she had been forced to bring her children to the house, she had watched them while they played outside like a hawk and yelled their names whenever they got too far away from the house. She had given this stalker information about her own children, and this was proof that he was in fact watching the house and them. The letter asked specifically about one of their daughters claiming to have seen her painting on an easel on the enclosed porch. 657 Boulevard is anxious for you to move in. It has been years and years since young blood ruled the hallways of this house. Have you found all the secrets it holds yet? Will the young blood play in the basement, or are they too afraid to go down there alone? I would be very afraid if I were them. It is far away from the rest of the house. If you were upstairs, you would never hear them scream. Will they sleep in the attic, or will you all sleep on the second floor? Who has the bedroom facing the street? I'll know as soon as you move in. It will help me know who is in which bedroom. Then I can plan better. All the doors and windows in 657 Boulevard allow me to watch you and track you as you move through the house. Who am I? I am the watcher, and I have been in control of 657 Boulevard for the better part of 2 decades now. The Woods family turned it over to you. It was their time to move on and kindly sold it when I asked them to. I pass by many times a day. 657 Boulevard is my job, my life, my obsession. And now you are too, Broaddus family. Welcome to the product of your greed. Greed is what brought the past 3 families to 657 Boulevard, and now it has brought you to me. Have a happy moving in day. You know I will be watching. Obviously, Derek and Maria were not going to move into this house anytime soon, at least until this whole issue was resolved. And their new absence, as well as their agreement that they made with each other to not bring the children there anymore, it seemed to upset the watcher. The next letter that came was in July, and it said, "Where have you gone to? 657 Boulevard is missing you. The house is crying from all the pain it is going through. You have changed it and made it so fancy. You are stealing its history. It cries for the past and what it used to be in the time when I roamed its halls. The 1960s were a good time for 657 Boulevard when I ran from room to room imagining the life with the rich occupants there. The house was full of life and young blood. Then it got old and so did my father, but he kept watching until the day he died. And now I watch and wait for the day when the young blood will be mine again. 657 Boulevard is turning on me. It's coming after me. I don't understand why. What spell did you cast on it? It used to be my friend, and now it's my enemy. I am in charge of 657 Boulevard. It is not in charge of me. I will fend off its bad things and wait for it to become good again. It will not punish me. I will rise again. I will be patient and wait for this to pass and for you to bring the young blood back to me. 657 Boulevard needs young blood. It needs you. Come back. Let the young blood play again like I once did. Let the young blood sleep in 657 Boulevard. Stop changing it and let it alone." And this was not the last letter, even though you'll often see it reported that the Broaddus's only received 3 letters, but we'll get to that in a moment. This is truly spooky, really scary. I can't imagine being in the Broaddus's shoes because part of you would want to just write this off as a prank. You just spent a lot of money on this house. You're spending a lot of money to have it renovated. You've promised your kids that you're going to move in here, and you don't want to disappoint them or really yourself. But at the same time, these letters, they were scary. They were threatening. They sound like somebody who is seriously obsessed with the house and the people who are living there. So you don't really want to bring your children there and put them in potentially harm's way. So since their old house had sold and they certainly weren't moving into 657 Boulevard yet, the family moved in with Maria's parents while they made a decision about what to do and what their next step should be. They still had to pay the mortgage and keep the house up, you know, mow the lawn and all that jazz, but they knew in their hearts they couldn't move in there. The investigation began to figure out who was harassing and threatening this poor family. They started with the previous owners, the Woods. The police wanted to know if there had been multiple offers on the property because maybe somebody had made an offer and gotten rejected because of the Broaddus's offer. So possibly that person could be upset that they'd lost out on this house. Maybe these people were now trying to scare the Broaddus's away so the house would once again go up on the market and they could purchase it. The Woodses quickly debunked this theory, however. They said there'd only been two other offers. One person had found another house and they were already happily moved on, and the other person had had some health issues and they'd had to back out of their offer. So no one was really devastated about not getting 657 Boulevard. The postmark on the letters was tracked to Kearney, the USPS's distribution center for Northern Jersey. It made the most sense that it was someone in the neighborhood, since the person seemed to always be around and was able to witness things that they couldn't if they were just walking or driving by. The police and the Broaddus's agreed a neighbor in a close-by house was the most likely suspect. The easel on the enclosed porch was hidden from street view by trees. A person would have had to have been looking from the side or right up close in order to see it. The first letter was postmarked on June 4th before the sale was made public, and the Woodses had never even put up a for sale sign. However, the contractors had arrived to start work on the house June 3rd, the day before the letter was sent. So if somebody in the neighborhood had seen the Woodses moving out in May and then seen the contractors coming to start working on 657 Boulevard at the beginning of June, they would have possibly put two and two together and figured out that the Woodses had moved out and sold the house to somebody else, and these people were now doing renovations and restorations to the house. Another man who lived in the neighborhood had been talking casually to Derek about the other neighbors that lived close by, and he was giving Derek some information about the occupants of the house located between himself and the Broaddus's at 657 Boulevard. Now remember, this man would have had no clue that the Broaddus's were receiving these letters because the police had told Derek and Maria to be quiet about the letters, potentially because one of the neighbors could be sending them. So this guy was just talking about neighbors, and he mentioned that the people who lived next door to him and the Broaddus's, they were a little weird. They were a little strange. Peggy Langford lived there. She was a widow in her 90s, and the rest of the neighbors thought it was a little strange and odd that her grown children lived there with her. One of them, a man in his 60s named Michael, was described as a bit of an oddball. He didn't seem to work or have a job, and if he did, no one really knew what it was or when he went there. He was described as having a long white beard like Ernest Hemingway, and the family had occupied that house since the 60s. So obviously, immediately, Derek is like, I wonder if this is the Watcher family. And even though the neighbors admitted that the Langfords were kind of strange and Michael was definitely strange, everybody pretty much thought he was harmless. But Derek had a gut feeling that Michael Langford was the one sending these letters. He lived right next door. It would be easy for him to watch and see when the contractors were going in and out. He would have had a clear view of the enclosed porch where Derek's daughter was painting on the easel. It would be easy for him to listen out a window and hear Maria calling her children's names while they were playing in the yard. So Derek went to the police with this information, and the detectives admitted that they'd already kind of suspected Michael Langdon, and they'd even brought him in for questioning already. According to the police, Michael Langdon claimed to know nothing about the letters, nothing about this watcher, and they believed him, but the Broaddus's were not convinced. He had already looked into everyone that was in close proximity to him in the neighborhood, and the Langfords were the only people, the only family, that had been there since the 60s. He began his own investigation. He set up webcams outside of the house, and he hid inside the house at night with the lights off to see if he could catch anybody walking up to the property, putting something in the mailbox, or just watching from the street or from a car. The Broaddus's even sent a letter to the Langfords claiming that they were planning on tearing down 657 Boulevard, hoping to get some kind of reaction from these people, because if these people were the Watcher family, they'd probably have a pretty strong reaction to the house that they'd been, you know, destined to watch all their lives through generations being torn down. But nothing happened. Additionally, DNA from the letter was analyzed, and it was found to be the DNA of a woman. But it did not match the DNA of Maria or of Andrea Woods, the previous owner. This brought suspicion to Michael's sister, another grown woman in her 60s, and her name was Abby Langford. A private investigator who was hired by Derek and Maria was able to obtain a water bottle that was used by Abby so that they could test her DNA against the DNA of the letter, but that was not a match either. The private investigator also tracked down and located two convicted child sex predators living in the neighborhood, but they were both males and the DNA on the letter was a female's, so they were kind of ruled out. The Broadduses moved on from the Langford theory. They kind of had to, even though Derek never really let go of his gut feeling that Michael Langford or somebody in his family was responsible for the letters. But there was no proof. The DNA on the letter was a female's, so it couldn't have been Michael Langdon. It didn't match Abby Langdon. They had to move away from the Langdon theory and explore their other options. They began following other leads, although there really were not many. One of the painters, a man named Bill, who'd been working on the house, reported that the neighbors who lived behind 657 Boulevard would often sit out in their yard in two lawn chairs that were strangely close to the Broaddus's property. One day, Bill noticed that the owner, a man in his 60s, was sitting out there alone, but he wasn't facing his home. He was facing 657 Boulevard, as if he was watching it. The Broadduses hired two retired FBI agents, one of them who created a personality profile of the letter writer. The profile said that the fashion of writing suggested somebody who was older and a person who liked to read. He also thought there seemed to be real anger seething behind the words. Even though there was a surprising lack of profanity, which in his opinion suggested a less macho letter writer. The FBI agent who did this personality profile, he really didn't think that the writer was going to act on these words, but he did say that there was something in the writing style that suggested this person wasn't all there. I think the fact that this person is sending anonymous typewritten letters talking about young blood and what's in the walls of the house and they'll find it, that kind of suggests to me that this person isn't all there, but, you know, I'm not an FBI agent or anything, just a theory. So the thing about these letters that suggested to the FBI agent that the person might not have all their facilities in order was, for one, the first letter was dated Tuesday, June 4th, but June 4th had been a Wednesday. And there seemed to be a lot of hate towards the wealthy in general, as if this person had an aversion in general to anybody moving into the neighborhood who would change or alter the houses there. If anybody watches Shameless, I imagine this letter writer to be a lot like Frank Gallagher, who was really always vocal and open about discouraging gentrification of his neighborhood. And that's kind of how I see this person, as somebody who's like intelligent, but also not always logical and impulsive. Both Maria and Derek were struggling mentally with what was happening. They were paranoid about everything and everyone. Maria had to see a therapist who told her she was suffering from PTSD due to the ownership of that house. So they decided they really didn't have another choice. They had to put the house on the market, their dream house, the one they'd been hoping for and planning for. They had to sell it. They had to get away from it. But they had some challenges ahead of them, because even though they hadn't told anybody about the letters specifically, rumors had started to circulate about why the Broadduses had not yet moved into their house. I mean, this is a tight-knit neighborhood, right? And I feel like a lot of these neighborhoods, it's like Wisteria Lane, Desperate Housewives kind of setup. It's exactly how my neighborhood is. People are bored and they watch everything that's happening and they want to know who's moving in and who these people are. They come to your door with casseroles just so they can meet you and say, oh, you know, welcome to the neighborhood. But they're not trying to welcome you to the neighborhood. They just want to know like who you are and what you're about. So these people are all watching what's going on, and they see this young couple with three young children purchase this expensive house and put a lot of effort into it in remodeling it, and then they just don't move in, and this started a lot of gossip. And obviously, since the police had already interviewed Michael Langdon and asked him about the letters, there's no doubt that Michael told somebody, maybe Abby or another one of his siblings, and that person spread it around the neighborhood. They were insulted that they were even being considered as suspects. So obviously they're gonna gossip about what's going on with the Broaddus's. Somehow it got around. And this is exactly why I don't talk to my neighbors, because people are bored and they gossip and they wanna talk about you and they wanna talk about everybody with you. And you know, if they're talking about everybody with you, they're talking about you with other people. Just saying. So a real estate agent contacted Derek and told him that their client was in love with the house. They wanted to buy it. But there was just too much speculation going on about what happened with the house or what was happening with the house for this person to feel comfortable purchasing it. And anybody who was interested in purchasing the house was immediately sent a partial disclosure about the letters that the Broaddus's had received. Those who made serious offers on the house were given full copies of the letters. Maria and Derek could not imagine putting anybody else in the same position that they'd been put in, living in a house that they'd spent a lot of money on, only to find that somebody was stalking them. So if somebody wanted to buy the house, that was great, but they were gonna get the full story of what was going on, so they would go into that purchase with their eyes wide open. And so it's really no surprise that the house did not get sold, even when the price was lowered. And this got the Broaddus's thinking. They were doing the right thing by letting potential buyers know about the letters they were getting, but the Woods had sold them the house, not letting them know about the letter they'd received at all. And that wasn't right, according to Maria and Derek. The Woods had admitted to Maria and Derek that they'd gotten a letter from the watcher before they'd moved out, but they still let the Broaddus's move in, essentially walking into the web of some crazy stalker, and they hadn't said anything. A year after they closed on the house, the Broaddus's sued the Woods. The complaint states that the defendants, John and Andrea Woods, fraudulent, intentional, and negligent concealment and misrepresentation of material facts about the single-family dream home the plaintiffs were purchasing, despite knowing that potential harm could befall the plaintiffs and their three children. So basically, the Broaddus's felt that the Woods had intentionally sold them the house, knowing there was some creepy guy stalking it. The lawsuit was dismissed, leaving the Broaddus's no choice but to rent out 657 Boulevard until they could sell it. And this was no easy task either. Because of the lawsuit, the real story had gotten out and about, and now it was more widespread than ever before. And of course, people far and wide began to speculate about what was happening and who was responsible for this. At first, the people of Westfield were scared and they had to have a town meeting where the mayor basically calmed them and was like, there hasn't been a letter in over a year, just calm down and nothing's going on, you're all safe. According to the mayor, he said that the police had done an exhaustive investigation. Everything's fine, don't worry, go home, sleep peacefully, Westfield is safe. And the people of Westfield, they didn't really believe that for a minute because they wondered how the police could have done an exhaustive investigation when none of them had even been questioned. But within no time, the neighbors were gathering together to whisper amongst themselves about who could have been doing this. And they decided that it couldn't have possibly been anybody besides the Broaddus's themselves. They didn't know why, but it was most likely financially motivated. Maybe they'd purchased the house, not realizing how much it really was, and they got in over their heads. They couldn't afford the mortgage, so they concocted this whole story so that they could sue the Woods for the full price of the house, and they wouldn't have to worry about paying the mortgage or being able to afford the house because they'd have this huge settlement. The good people of Westfield, New Jersey took to the internet to spread their theories. One neighbor wrote that the Broaddus's had created this elaborate scheme in order to defraud the Woods family for millions of dollars. And it really seemed like the neighbors were more concerned that this publicity and this story was making Westfield look bad. they weren't really too concerned about the potential consequences of a psychotic letter writer threatening the Broaddus's, because honestly, they didn't really know the Broaddus's, right? Derek and Maria and their children, they never moved in, so the neighbors never really got to know them or view them in a neighborly way. So they were like, who are these people coming in here talking crap about our neighborhood and making us look bad on a national level? Because this story did spread nationwide. The Cut did an extensive article on this case in cooperation with the Broaddus's, and the reporter says that when he interviewed residents from the town, many of them were worried about their property values going down. So you might say that their purpose in blaming the Broaddus's was also financially motivated. Finally, the Broaddus's found somebody to rent 657 Boulevard. A nice little family with grown children and a couple of dogs, they decided to move in. They had full knowledge of the letters that the Broaddus's had received. The renter gave a comment to a local paper saying he wasn't too concerned about these letters, but he did have a clause in his rental agreement saying that if any more letters came, he could pretty much leave without any consequences. And of course, another letter did arrive. It was 2 weeks later. It was dated February 13th, and it was addressed to the spiteful Derek and his wench of a wife, Maria. Why would another letter not have arrived? Maria and Derek had finally got a streak of good luck. They'd found somebody to rent their house so they weren't facing complete financial ruin, and the watcher couldn't have that. This letter said, "You wonder who the watcher is. Turn around, idiots. Maybe you even spoke to me, one of the so-called neighbors who has no idea who the watcher could be. Or maybe you do know and are too scared to tell anyone. Good move. I watched as you watched from the dark house in an attempt to find me. Telescopes and binoculars are wonderful inventions. My soldiers of the boulevard followed my orders to a T. They carried out their mission and saved the soul of 657 Boulevard with my orders. All hail the Watcher." The letter writer threatened the Broaddus's, telling them that he would get his revenge on them. Maybe a car accident, maybe a fire, maybe something as simple as a mild illness that never seems to go away but makes you feel sick day after day after day after day. Maybe the mysterious death of a pet, loved ones suddenly die, planes and cars and bicycles crash, bones break, you are despised by the house and the watcher won. I can't even imagine getting a letter like this. Like, I cannot even imagine. I would be legitimately terrified. All right, so they purchased this house in 2014, right? And they never moved in. And this house, 657 Boulevard, did not sell until this past July, just a couple of months ago, July of 2019. Which is crazy because this is, once again, a gorgeous house and they lowered the price way down. But the mystery of the watcher and whoever was writing these letters was strong enough to prevent anybody from wanting to move in there. Derek and Maria had to keep lowering the price until it sold for $959,000. And obviously, that's a lot of money, but it's significantly less than what they bought it for. Plus, they put $100,000 into it just in renovations alone. So what are some theories about what could have happened here in this idyllic New Jersey neighborhood with this nice family about to move into their dream home? How could it have gone so wrong? All the families who had lived there before the Broaddus's claimed they'd never had any issues, that they'd never received any letters, besides that one that the Woods had gotten a month before the Broaddus's were set to move in. In 1913, it had been lived in by a man named William Davies, who served one term as the town's mayor in 1932. A few other families occupied it, and then a family called the Bakes moved in, who I believe were there for 40 years. They weren't around to ask, but their children remember having a happy childhood, and they never heard anything about the Watcher. So here's my thing about that. If parents are receiving scary letters, they're probably not going to tell their young children that they're receiving letters from a man or a woman who is stalking their house and talking about bringing young blood to them. So if the parents of these people who claim they never heard anything about the Watcher when they were kids did receive these threatening letters, they most likely wouldn't have shared it with their children, especially if the letters had stopped before their children became adults. It may have just been a thing that happened and it scared them for a year or two, but then it stopped happening, so they didn't feel the need to tell their children later on. Another thing is, in the original letter, the writer had said that his grandfather had watched the house in the 20s and his father in the 60s. So how do we know that it wasn't one of these original families who were actually the watchers of the house and passed that job down to their kids? So how do we know it wasn't one of these kids that were being questioned and saying that they never heard anything about the Watcher? One of the letters recalls running through the halls of the house as if they lived there at one point, or at least spent a lot of time there. Also, there seems to be a familiarity with the inside of the house, such as where the bedrooms are located, or how far away the basement is from the second floor, etc. That suggests to me somebody who has not only been inside, but has been inside enough to have gotten a good idea what the floor plan is like. Now, the next door neighbor, Michael Langdon, is always a favorite suspect for internet sleuths. He was diagnosed with schizophrenia when he was a child, and he had a tendency to creep around and kind of scare new neighbors by looking in their windows. Additionally, the first time when the police had allegedly interviewed Michael Langdon and asked him, you know, what was going on, did he have anything to do with the letters, they told the Broaddus's that he said he hadn't had anything to do with it and they believed him, but they also said that they wouldn't be receiving any more letters from now on, which obviously wasn't true. But how would they have known that or been confident enough to tell the Broaddus's, don't worry, you're good now, you won't be getting any more letters, after talking to him once, if they didn't suspect him of being the person who wrote the letters and they kind of told him to stop and he said he would, and so they believed him and told the Broaddus's, like, you're all set, no more letters are coming. The police also alluded to Derek and Maria that Michael had echoed some of the sentiments from the Watcher letters in their interview with him. The Langford home obviously also put Michael front and center in perfect eye shot and earshot of the Broaddus home so he could see what was happening and hear what was happening. And it's possible and probable that Michael Langford would have had access to 657 Boulevard when he was a kid. If there had been children living at 657 Broaddus, they probably would have been friends with Michael Langford and his siblings, and he most likely would have played in their house. So he would have remembered running through the halls as a child. So the Langfords obviously did not appreciate being put under this microscope and being considered suspects, and Michael was brought in for a second interview with the police. The Broaddus's and their lawyers met with the Langfords and showed them the letters and showed them pictures that they'd taken to illustrate how close the Langford home was to 657 Boulevard and how you could see the enclosed porch and you could kind of see in through the house and you'd be able to have full access to the yard. Abby Langford accused the police and the Broaddus's of harassing their family. Abby and Michael's brother, Sandy Langford, said, quote, my family moved to the Boulevard in 1961, and we never caused a problem for anybody. This guy gets all these letters, and all of a sudden, people are pointing fingers. Abby Langford is also a popular suspect for the online community. She was a real estate agent, and some speculate that she was mad that the Woods hadn't given her the listing of 657 Boulevard. It was an expensive house, and it would have been a really good commission. So she nailed two birds with one stone when she sent these scary letters to the Broaddus's and implicated the Woods at the same time. Maybe she'd hoped that she could become friendly with Derek and Maria, and by the time they were so scared they wanted to sell the house, she would be right there, a real estate agent living right next door, and they would just give her the listing. But the story got so out of control and so widespread that when her family was put at the epicenter of it and were considered suspects by the Broaddus's, obviously Derek and Maria aren't going to ask her to help them sell their house. Something she said in a town meeting also drew people's attention. When the Broaddus's were having a hard time finding someone to buy or rent the house, their lawyer made a suggestion. Why not sell the house and the land to a developer who would tear it down and build two smaller properties on that land? But the other people living in the neighborhood hated that idea. And the Broaddus's would need permission from the Westfield Planning Committee in order to go ahead with this plan. The board had a 3-hour meeting about the situation where neighbors stood and said things like, our neighborhoods are constantly under attack from turf, lights, parking decks, you name it. If we can't make a stand on the Boulevard, where can we? And then Abby Langford gets up and says she has spent 60 years looking at a magnificent, beautiful house and didn't want to be looking out at a driveway. So there's that. What you looking at, Abby? What you watching? Right after the Broaddus's were planning on filing a civil suit against the Langfords because they were so certain that the Langfords were responsible for sending the letters, the police told the Broaddus's and the Langfords that the Langfords had been completely eliminated as suspects, but they never explained why. My money is on the mom, Peggy. Female DNA. Old person has nothing better to do than sit around the house and watch what's going on in the neighborhood. I'm just saying it's possible, and maybe the police found out that Peggy Langford was responsible for sending these letters, and they weren't going to like take a 90-year-old woman in and arrest her for harassment or for sending these letters. So they swept it under the rug, and they were just like, okay, they're not suspects anymore, and they never gave a reason why. And there's another suspect. One night, the police were staking out the house, 657 Boulevard, when a car pulled up in front of the house at about 11 p.m. The police traced the car to a girlfriend of a guy who lived on the same block as the Broaddus's. When the woman was questioned, she said that her boyfriend liked to play these really dark video games, and in one of these dark video games, he played as a character called the Watcher. The boyfriend allegedly wasn't around at this time that the police wanted to question him. He was out of town or something, but the police got in contact with him, and they scheduled two separate interviews to speak with him, both of which he missed. He never showed up. Since they didn't have enough evidence to compel him to come in, they basically just dropped it and they didn't pursue it. And let's talk about the lawn chair people who lived behind the Broaddus's. Remember that painter said that the couple who lived behind 657 Boulevard would put their lawn chairs really close to the property of the Broaddus's and then sit in the lawn chairs facing the Broaddus home? Well, the guy who lived back there, he was interviewed, and it turned out that he had a daughter who grew up to marry a man who had lived at 657 Boulevard. Additionally, that neighbor to the back of the Broaddus property, he'd lived there for 47 years, and he'd made a joke that his son told him the letters from the Watcher sounded like something he would say and he would write. That's not a funny joke. Like, it's not a funny joke. From their lawn chairs, the couple who lived in that house would be able to clearly see the Broaddus home, to hear if the kids' names were being yelled, and they also had full view of that enclosed porch where the little girl was painting on her easel, and it was mentioned in the Watcher letters. And of course, there's the theory that the Broadduses themselves are responsible. And I think that theory comes from the pure unbelievableness of this story. Unbelievableness isn't a word, but in this case, you know what I mean. This story is one of those stranger than fiction stories, and it's hard to believe that this could actually happen to people. So logically, our brains are like, it's the Broaddus's, it's Derek and Maria. They did this to themselves because that's the only possible explanation. It seems like something you'd see in a movie, and these things don't happen in real life unless they're like pranks or setups or it's like a skit. Those who believe Derek and Maria were behind writing the letters say that they must have had some financial motive, when in fact, they lost a lot of money in this situation. Bottom line, they lost $400,000 just on like the sale of the house and the renovations. Additionally, all the money that they spent on private investigators and retired FBI agents and just lab tests testing DNA, they really benefited from this? Not at all. Derek and Maria describe this time in their life as an actual nightmare. They can barely even go near that neighborhood anymore because of what it triggers in them. On top of that, if you look at their backgrounds, Derek and Maria seem like really, really good people. Or at least people who have done a lot of good. They both met when they were studying at the Catholic University of Fairfield in Connecticut. After graduation, they moved to New York for Derek's job. They bought their starter home in Scotch Plains, New Jersey in 2002 for $300,000. Derek was a devout Catholic and a philanthropist who helped raise $13,000 for Children's Cancer Charity in 2012. The year before, Maria and Derek were both listed as donors for Camp Sunshine, which is a retreat for children with life-threatening illnesses. Maria herself won a humanitarian award for her charity work. She volunteered at a summer camp for kids with cancer, and she spent some time in Arizona after she graduated working at a counseling agency for abused children. I'm sorry, but I just don't see people like that participating in a scam like this, especially when it seems to have not benefited them at all. They don't like the publicity. They don't really want to be interviewed or talk about this. They didn't make any money off of it. And I know there's going to be people in the comments who are like, just because they're Catholic doesn't mean they're good people. And I agree with you. These are people that raised money for children's cancer. They were philanthropists. They were kind people who think about other people besides themselves. And I just don't see them doing something like this, especially, like I said, when they seem to gain nothing from it. Additionally, they were so honest about disclosing what was happening to potential renters or buyers when they could have just hid it and sold the house for more than they bought it for because they'd done so much renovation. They could have kept that to themselves, but they wanted to do the right thing and they didn't want to be tricked as they felt that they had been tricked by the woods. So they disclosed all of this. They seem like people who kind of do the right thing and follow the rules, and I just don't see it, guys. Let me know in the comments if you think I'm wrong, but I just don't see it. But it is creepy. The letters, the things written in them, the threats against the family and their children. This could have been a twisted game or a prank being played on the Broaddus's by someone in the neighborhood, maybe a gang of teenage kids that was bored, even a bored housewife. But talking about not being able to hear their kids scream if they were in the basement and continuing to send the letters, it just took it too far. I have a feeling that the letters were written by someone in the neighborhood, someone who had been there for a long time and maybe wasn't mentally all there, their tone switching from taunting to outright insulting. If it was a game or a joke or a prank, this person had some serious follow-through. The letters weren't placed in the mailbox, they were sent, and they could have been sent from anywhere or dropped in any mailbox in that area. Putting cameras up didn't help because this person never allowed themselves to be seen, even stating in one of the letters that telescopes and binoculars are helpful. He or she always seemed to know what they were doing, always seemed to be a couple steps ahead of the Broaddus's. It had to have been someone close and someone who lived there full time and was able to watch as much as they wanted. So it looks like Netflix has purchased the rights to this story in December of 2018. Even though Lifetime tried to make some janky, unauthorized version of this case years ago and it was really awful. Apparently, there was a bidding war of 5 networks for the story and Netflix won. I don't know if it's gonna be a movie or a series. Personally, I'm hoping for a really bingeable series like Light as a Feather. If you haven't seen that on Netflix, it was really good, really bingeable, but I'm hoping for something like that. I prefer a series to a movie because I think there's so much about this story that can be fleshed out and brought to life on the screen. But we'll see what happens. It just goes to show you that this story is literally stranger than fiction and was made for the movie or television screen. Except it really happened and it's kind of spooky. It's really spooky. Okay, it's really spooky. Let me know what you guys think in the comments. Do you think it was the Langfords? Do you think it was the weird neighbors behind the Broaddus's who were always facing their lawn chairs toward the Broaddus home? Do you think it was that weird guy who played the video game and called himself the Watcher, but the police never could really pin him down? Do you think it was just a random neighbor playing a trick? Do you think it was the Broaddus's themselves? There's so many theories and so many potential options. What do you guys think is the right theory or the most likely theory? Or if you have another theory, please let me know that in the comments. Before we go, I just want to tell you that the eyeshadow palette I've been wearing on my eyes all month is this So Jada palette by Kathleen Lights. And like I said, I did record my fall favorites video this morning, so I have this right here. But it's awesome. There's so many looks. I think it's perfect for fall because it's got these oranges and these pretty teals and purples and these really nice jewel tone colors. But this palette is awesome. I think it's the biggest palette ColourPop has ever made, but I love it. It blends like a dream. It's beautiful. I'm wearing it on my eyes today. I've worn it on my eyes every single video you've seen me record in October. I have had this on and I love it. And Kathleen is such an amazing, sweet person and such a down-to-earth and like kind person. I've never heard her say a mean word about anybody or anything. So she's awesome and this palette's awesome. I love ColourPop eyeshadows. They're just really good. And then what I've been wearing on my lips, because it's fall and I kind of wanted like more of a glossy look, so I've stopped wearing liquid lipstick as much. I've been wearing these ColourPop Just a Tint lipsticks. I have this one on today and it's called Cherry Pickin', even though it's more brown to me than red. And this one's called Chubby Bunny. And somebody said in one of my comments that this looked like a dupe for something, but I forget what it was. But these are awesome. They stay on for a really long time and they make your lips feel like soft and moisturized. And even when the glossy part comes off, there's still color left behind. So I really do like these and they're affordable. So that's what I've been wearing on my lips and my eyes for the majority of my Halloween videos. That's what you see. And like I said, if you want to check out the palette or the ColourPop lip tints, there are links in the description box. You can check them out. But they're great. Thank you guys so much for being here. This was a really fun and interesting one to do and really spooky. Once again, let me know what you think in the comments. Stay kind and stay beautiful, and I'll see you next time. Bye.
thinking about the way your smile lights up a room, like a sliver of the moon in the summer sky.